watching the effect of the fire with his binoculars, he spotted the glint of sunlight on shiny metal as hidden Confederate troops scattered from the shell fire. Warren immediately called for reserves to help hold this vital position. The exposed and surprised Confederates struck back quickly and hard.
Come on, hold your bellies!
The Confederates swarmed over the lower slope of Big Round Top and up the south face of Little Round Top. Just at the critical moment, Union reserves summoned by Warren appeared and engaged the attackers at point-blank range.
Fire!
Up the hill! Forward, men! Forward! Come on!
Charge! Charge! Charge!
Keep firing!
Oh!
Finally, the added Union strength prevailed and slowly but surely pushed back the hard-fighting Confederates. Little Round Top, a strategic point, was saved. The Confederates reformed at Devil's Den. There, behind the shelter of rocks and barricades, their sharpshooters picked off Union soldiers and officers on the distant hill. During the night, the Northern forces built up rock breastworks of their own. The wheat field had been cleared of Union troops by the attacking Confederates, and General Meade summoned a division of reserves in an effort to regain it. Part of this division included the famous Irish Brigade, whose chaplain, Father William Corby, halted them for a moment, mounted a rock, and gave the troops conditional absolution. Regained the wheat field, but shortly after lost it again to attacking Confederate forces. Farther north, where the Union line had been weakened in an effort to support the left flank, two brigades of Confederate troops came pouring through a gap. General Hancock promptly ordered the 1st Minnesota Regiment to plug up the hole in the line. While hopelessly outnumbered, the impact of the desperate Minnesota attack checked the Confederate forces, giving Hancock enough time to realign his troops. But 82%, about 7 out of every 8 of the 1st Minnesota, lay killed or wounded on the battlefield. When nightfall ended the carnage in the second day of the battle, the Confederates had been held at bay in front of Cemetery Ridge and in the Culp's Hill sector, but the losses on both sides had been frightful. Light of the moon, men searched the bloody fields for dead or torn comrades while others rested, not knowing what grim business lay ahead of them on the third and final day of the battle. On the morning of the third day, there was some hard fighting near Spangler Spring. Then, there was
was quiet.
During this lull, General Lee regrouped his forces. He was planning an attack on the right wing of the Federal lines, hoping to keep the Union's reserves occupied so that he might make a bold and sudden thrust through the center, hoping thereby to cut the opposing army in two parts. His plan also was to have Jeb Stuart's cavalry appear at the rear of the Union lines in order to complete the destruction. Union General Meade waited for the attack. His plan was to stand firm until the Confederates were well within range and then meet the attack head-on and at both flanks. For 2 hours, beginning at 1 p.m, Confederate artillery shelled the center of the Union lines with 138 guns. Artillery duel clouded the field as the fire finally ceased. And then, led by General Pickett, 15,000 Confederates, lines dressed, stepping in cadence, followed their generals and their flags up Cemetery Ridge. As the magnificent Southern ranks marched into battle, General Meade and his Northern forces waited. Pickett's objective was a clump of oak trees. As they came into view, he swung his line slightly to the left and resumed the march. Guns from Round Top to Cemetery Ridge were belching and blasting iron death into the ranks of the Confederates. But they moved on. They crossed Emmitsburg Road, passed Cadore's farmhouse, and then dashed for the stone wall,